Cloud Dynamics International. And on the validation side, we have done quite a bit of tools that make the iPSC research a little easier. On the live alkaline phosphatase dye, which is able to recognize cells that are emerging when the reprogramming takes place, the emerging colonies can be identified quickly without losing any of those cells with the live dye that disappears after a little time. And similarly, we have also developed with Alex Wiesner from Harvard University on a scorecard that could possibly characterize any kind of the iPS line with the characteristic panel that has to show up, or when the cells go into differentiation mode, what kind of lineage they are getting into, and this kind of things. And with that, I'll be focusing a little bit on differentiation, what we are doing, and you know, how these reagents are helping on the differentiation side. So what is a cellular differentiation? So very simply to put it, is converting a less specialized cell becoming a more specialized cell. Or in other words, becoming a stem cell and getting differentiated into a functionally mature cell type is the process of differentiation. And this naturally happens in the body, in the human body, that is responsible for generating all the organs that we see in the body. But iPSCs in vitro, if you want to reflect that process in vitro, we need to understand a lot on iPSC biology. And then we have to take these iPS cells, or pluripotent cells, they have to be taken through a series of step-by-step analysis to design and mimic what happens within the body to produce the desired cell types that ultimately are responsible for organogenesis. So why is this differentiation is important? You know, the whole human body originates from three germ layers, ectoderm, mesoderm, and endoderm. And whether human ESC or iPSC have to be taken through those germ layer differentiation to ultimately give rise to different cell types that you see on the right-hand side, on the ectoderm towards neural and skin, mesoderm towards cardiac, blood, and other kind of vascular cells, and the endoderm on the pancreatic, hepatic, and other kind of cells like intestinal cells and all that. And you see on the bottom why this becomes more important, the differentiation process becomes more important in the sense that at any point of time, even for cell therapy, what is one of the main aims of stem cells is that they'll fill in that gap for ultimately they'll be suitable at someday for cell therapy purposes. They need to be generated in different kind of cell numbers. For example, in brain, which is on the bottom side, is that one may not need a lot many number of cells. You may need 50,000 cells or 100,000 cells for implantation to the brain. Whereas for cardiac cells, you need minimum 1 to 10 to the power 9 or 2 to 10 to the power 9 kind of cells for transplantation purposes. So if you want that many number of cells, they need to be homogeneous. They need to be produced very efficiently. So if they need to be produced efficiently, we need a differentiation protocol or a differentiation process that has to be well-defined and well-reproducible and in a regulatory compliant manner, because these cells will go ultimately into cell therapy or drug discovery. So if you look into the technology status on differentiation, these are the things that come up in the field. So there are very limited number of ready-to-use kits availability. A lot of researchers have their own homebrew methods, which differ from one researcher to the other, and the reproducibility is a huge issue, and the raw materials that go into have a very highly differing kind of phenomena. And they are not robust. So methods are complicated. Some of them are step-by-step, some of them are sequential, some of them are parallel. So, and a lot of methods for differentiation for all the tissues, for all the three germ layers, for final mature cell types, still in a lot of development, I would say, and a lot of protocols are also very inefficient. So, and these are all not well validated. Very poor quality of differentiated cells, very low marker expression, and on the functional side, which is the real litmus test for all this differentiated progeny, is really poor functionality of the cells. You can take any number of examples like hepatic cells. We can convert them into hepatic cells. iPSCs can be converted into hepatic cells, but the performance compared to the fetal hepatocyte is close only by 20% or 30%. So a wide range of differentiation protocols are currently available from researchers, but they need to be made more efficient, shorter, or standardized, and some of them take a really long time as well. So they need to be standardized, and they need to be made in a way for researchers that it is easy to use and highly reproducible. when they are used. And the function tests that are really carried out for most of these differentiated progeny, a lot of tests need to be performed on all this, not just only an in vitro functional analysis, the gene expression from a starting cell type, what is the desired cell morphology, gene expression, and when these differentiated progeny are on their way to differentiation process, if these are transplanted, whether they will mimic what happens within the body, or whether they will integrate with in vivo organogenesis integration, and when they're transplanted into animal models, do they show what they are expected of? Do they perform for what they were inducted? So there are, the whole field, as I mentioned, the differentiation process is complex, and there are many ways. So one cell, if it reproduces itself exactly like the mother cell, you call it as expansion, whereas if it is a different cell type, slightly changing its phenotype and functionality, you call it as a differentiation process. And this differentiation process currently is going through a lot. There are many routes to get to that differentiation process. So one of the things is, we have known quite a bit since 2006, you take a differentiated cell and push it back to iPSC process. So we have reasonably come a long way to understand that process. And how we can do it, and what is happening, and some of these things. What are the transcription factors that play towards, and then they go into a totipotent kind of cells, like the pluripotent cells. But the reverse process, from taking from iPSC, which is a totipotent or pluripotent cell, from that pluripotent cell to a unipotent differentiated cell process is still complex. And there are parallel ways that are also going on. Researchers are taking one differentiated cell and directly converting into another differentiated cell type, a kind of trans-differentiation process, bypassing the pluripotency state within these cells. So a kind of lineage reprogramming. So there are many ways to get to differentiation, apart from the exciting science of understanding, what exactly suits you for your differentiation purpose is ultimately the need for every researcher to figure out which way one needs to go. And on the sulfate dehiscence, so when a cell is converting from one simple cell, stem cell, to a differentiated state, particularly for pluripotent cells, I would say if you take a pluripotent cell, it has definitely four or five different states. Either it is quiescent without replication, or it is going through a self-renewal process, or it is getting differentiated. If any of this is not happening and the conditions are not to its advantage, the cell also is apoptosing. So it is also undergoing apoptosis, meaning that it will die off. So in order for these four cell states to maintain, one has to get through quite a number of the environment in which these cells are either cultured in vitro or whether they are the environmental niche that is present in vivo. The extracellular matrix, the soluble factors around in the culture media or in the extracellular fluid, the cell-cell interactions that take place, and the physical forces that are present between the cells and the physical chemical environment, all of them become really, really important when we like to mimic, to replicate those kind of conditions that exist in vivo in vitro cultures. And that was the crux to get the differentiation kind of process. So on the Thermo Fisher Scientific side, we have developed some kind of medias that enable differentiation of pluripotent stem cells to neuroectodermal lineage. And let me show you some data on that. So on the neural differentiation, one of the complex things about brain is that even though brain is made of a lot of neurons, all neurons are not equal and all neurons are not similar. So there are multiple subtypes and the brain has not only front brain, midbrain, and hindbrain position, there's also a dorsal and ventral positional cues that exist in brain. So these kind of stereotaxic kind of conditions and positional information has to be present when you develop the neural stem cells. If you want to develop a motor neuron, it has to have that kind of identity to brought forward. Similarly, for a Parkinson's disease, if one has to develop dopaminergic neurons, that kind of information has to be present. So to advance this, both on the neuronal side and the non-neural glial cell side, there are quite a bit of advances that are happening. And on our side, one of the things that we have done is that if you look into the current methodologies that are practiced as of today as well, is that there are very tedious protocols that are adopted by researchers. That's how it was. We learned quite a bit from the mouse models. And that is the same model that has been extended to human cells. And these methods use an embryoid body formation, and I call it as a Rosette method because you start with anchorage-dependent cells, then you make them into a suspension cell type that form the embryoid body. And these embryoid bodies are collected again and plated on a matrix-coated plates, either with the polyelastin and laminin. And then you make what are called as rosette structures that are developed on this as an adherent culture. And out of these rosette structures, the rosette structure is isolated, which is like a web. And from these rosette structures, neural stem cells are isolated. And what I'm showing in the bottom line is that if you start with 1 million cells on the left hand, ultimately the efficiency could be the neural stem cells that are really good positive for nestin, SOX1, SOX2, and this kind of specific markers for neural stem cells. Approximately make it 1 million cells if your rosette isolation method is good. But the whole process involves very tedious, very subjective, very manual kind of process that leads to variations from researcher to other researcher, and also the efficiencies and the quality of the cells that come out at the end of it. And added to that, there are two other disadvantages in the sense that these cells lack positional cues. So you can only make one type of neurons out of this, or you can make glial cells out of it. But all type of neurons cannot be generated from these rosettes. If you want all type of neurons, you have to go back again and do the neural specification and repeat the process for each cell type differently. And efficiencies are poor. But what we have done, very recently we launched a media called neural induction medium. So you start with 1 million cells, and it doesn't involve embryoid body formation. It bypasses the embryoid body formation or rosette picking. It is a simple monolayer culture, and you harvest neural stem cells on day 7. And these neural stem cells are expandable. You can expand them to multiple generations. And their efficiencies, whatever I'm showing there, 1 million to 20 million, is from disease lines. From normal cell lines, we get more than 40 million, depending on from healthy individual donors or from healthy iPSC lines or human ESC lines. From disease lines, you get anywhere from 20 million and sometimes less. Right? So this one, 7 days. And the advantage with these cells is, if you look into the gene signature that I'm going to show you later, is that they maintain the stem cell, the primitive neural stem cell state, which has a proportional front brain markers, midbrain markers, and hindbrain markers. So as a result of that, what happens is, if you can generate a differentiation process for front brain neurons, or midbrain neurons, or hindbrain neurons, they all can be generated. With differing efficiencies. So it is a very high efficiency. At this point of time, the neural stem cells that I'm talking about, day 7, these are about 90% pure with any kind of markers that you see are compared with the human fetal brain as well. And no embryoid body, very high efficiency process, no rosette picking, time, labor, variability, all of them are reduced. And this is the gene expression panel. So on the multidimensional plot, you could see on the left-hand side is the fetal, the green one, the green bubble that is showing up is the human fetal NSE. And on the right-hand side on the top is the P0 NSE that we have generated. And on the bottom of that is the after expansion of these cells, and then the human fetal kind of thing. So they all are, they fall on the same multidimensional screening plot. And the dendrogram, as you see, they are all very closely related. Similarly, if you look at the gene expression analysis, whether you compare with rosette-derived NSE versus this monolayer-derived NSE, you see on the regression analysis is greater than 80% on all of them. Similarly, whether P0 or P6 expansion, similarly PNSE versus fetal NSE, you can see the fetal NSE is about 76% close, so meaning that most of the NSC genes, as I'm going to show you in the next slide, is that if you group them together on the heat maps, you can see the NSC-related genes, they all fall, the specific NSC genes, they all fall very closely on it. And similarly, you can see the telencephalic front brain genes, and the midbrain genes, and the hindbrain genes, and the positional genes for dorsal ventral genes are all well maintained. On the right-hand far corner, I will also show, as the cells expand, they become better and better. The reason being, the non-neural genes that are still present, some of them, like the brachyury and all of them, they get subsided over their next round of expansions. And the expansion, as I mentioned, it is 1 to 40, the first derivation process. After that, at any point of time, expansion is 1 to 10 ratios. So as a consequence, a billion cells could be made in less than 3 weeks with one bottle of media. So that is the power of this technology. And a lot of these details, the gene expression analysis and all that, is published in the paper in the last November in Stem Cell Translational Medicine. So from these, we have also shown the proof of concept that, you know, from the neural stem cells, expanded up to passes 6, where you have almost like 2 billion cells that are made. From these neural stem cells, you should still be able to make GABA neurons for diseases like epilepsy, schizophrenia. You can model those ones. The efficiency is around 30 or 40% as of now, with no differentiation methods for GABA neurons. Similarly, for midbrain dopaminergic neurons, the efficiencies are somewhere around 30 to 35%, which is not bad. And these dopaminergic neurons are really authentic dopaminergic neurons in the sense these are A9 categorized dopaminergic neurons that engraft in Parkinson's disease models. That is really the litmus test for these cells. We can generate those cell types. Similarly, on the hindbrain, motor neurons can be generated for diseases like ALS or multiple sclerosis and these kind of diseases that can be modeled well. And all these different protocols have been very detailedly described in that publication where you can get information on how to generate from this neural induction media derived NSC, how one could make the GABA neurons or dopaminergic neurons or motor neurons. So Kurt Vogel, who is here, will be talking about how we have taken these NSCs that are derived from neural induction media from Parkinson's disease human patient iPS lines. He's going to talk about, we have generated roughly about 7 or 8 different lines, including some of them control patients, and about 4 disease patients. That data he's going to talk to you a little later, so I'm just skipping just to give you an indication that Kurt Vogel will be talking how the neurons can be used from this, and how they could be used in disease modeling and drug discovery purposes, or for engineering purposes to, you know, to take off this gene and insert a new gene in its place. So the summary that we have learned, at least on the directed differentiation culture, is that you know, we need to have a proper starting cell type. If the efficiency of neural stem cells is high to begin with, if you have a 90% neural stem cells, your efficiency of downstream differentiation also is much better. Compare that with the ROSA-derived NSC, where your efficiencies are only 30% or 40%. If your beginning population is 30% or 40%, automatically your downstream differentiation lineages will be poorer. Similarly, the culture medium, you need to have factors that promote the differentiation process. And differentiation-inducing agents have to be there. And there are quite a bit of timing issues. For example, some of the motor neurons, they may take 90 days of development, or oligodendrocyte may take 90 days of development. There is no still a shortcut for this kind of developmental blocks that we have in this kind of cell biology purposes, but we are working on different ways how to get to this kind of different cell types. So this is one media, the neural induction media. So similarly, we have done, we are just launching at this point of time a differentiation media for cardiomyocytes. So let me show some data on this cardiomyocyte lineage differentiation. So there's a very nice review published by Dr. Christian Mummery, 2012, where she showed that most of the iPS-related cardiac differentiation protocols really almost mimic the embryonic cardiac development that we see in human beings. And in this kind of the path of embryonic cardiac development, is well deciphered, so starting is well identified. Starting from the pluripotent cell, one could get into a pro-mesoderm lineages, and then from pro-mesoderm to mesoderm lineages, and then cardiac specification, and you can get a building cardiomyocytes with specified transcriptional markers like MIXL1 and the MESP1 at the later stage, and similarly with the ways to identify a cell surface marker so that you can identify this population early on. You can fact sort, you can fact analyze, you can lay your hands on the cells to further refine the process. So this cardiomyocyte differentiation is very important in the study of in vitro models, to generate in vitro models to study human cardiac development, both in healthy and disease conditions. And it's also very important to develop new cardioactive compounds, similarly to screen compounds that cause cardiotoxicity, and ultimately at some point, these cells are required for cell therapy purposes if they can rescue conditions like AMI and others, acute cardiomyocyte induction. But what is important, so the whole process is understood very well, but what is most important is how can we generate efficient and reproducible protocols needed. So there have been quite a number of methods. I still borrow another figure from her review, is that this is a summary of all the current methods that are available for IPS or PSC cardiac differentiation. Most of the methods, early on methods, again, we borrowed it from the mouse system, and then these are all based on embryoid body formation. And in this embryoid body formation, now there are smaller ones, bigger aggregate cultures, and then microwave plated cultures, quite a number of different varieties. And then you take them through specific growth factors, chemokines and cytokines to get to the attached cardiac beating cells. Their efficiencies matter a lot in these kind of cultures. They are highly variable. And one of our own media, we made a media called Stembro 34, which is actually we made it for expanding hematopoietic stem cells. But this media has worked for several researchers, including Christian Mummery and Gordon Keller and others. But unfortunately, this media was not made for cardiac purposes. There is something in the Stembro 34 media that enables cardiac, but it is not uniform. So there is a clear variation. It is not sufficient enough. And the variability continues to be a factor if we are using Stembro 34. Similarly, researchers used another reagent from us, which is called B27. So B27 was originally developed for rat hippocampal neurons. But this media also helps in getting to beating cardiomyocytes when you start from iPSC. Again, that method yields you beating cardiomyocytes, maybe with less efficiency, maybe poor population, and very inefficient, and reproducibility is an issue for this. Because these two media that we roll up were originally not meant for cardiac at all. So then, of late, I know there have been other method. People have been, and the researchers have been slightly shying away from embryoid body because of the differences, difficulties, variabilities that are associated with this kind of embryoid body-based differentiation. And then they switch to monolayer cultures. So in the monolayer cultures, you plate the aggregates in a small clumps, and these small clumps of pluripotent cells are taken to, in a kind of single monolayer culture or multiple co-cultures and this kind of stuff. And also they are matrixed. So in a kind of matrixed gel cultures, you plate the cells, and then you still coat with Geltrex or matrix gel coated on one hand, create a kind of three-dimensional environment for the cells to form cardiac differentiation. And even then, these are all very inefficient. And then the other method that actually Christian Mummery's lab developed is using co-cultures with cells like endo2 and other kind of cells or endothelial kind of cultures where this co-culture is developed where you'll start seeing breeding cardiomyocytes developed. So most of these methods have undefined components or variation efficiencies. They all matter a lot. So what we have done recently is that in a very simple and short protocol, we have developed a medium. For the first, we can plate the human embryonic stem cells or pluripotent cells on a plate, allow them for 2 to 3 days to settle in essential media, egg media, which is a very clearly defined media, and then take it to from 0 to 2 a stem cell supplement media, supplement called A, and from 3 to 4 days. Use the separate supplement called supplement B, and then use the maturation media, maintenance media for cardiomyocytes. So these ones, generally, the system is very simple. It's composed of 3 1x ready-to-use kind of media. You change media for first 2 days, second 2 days, and then you have the maintenance media to generate the cardiomyocytes. Starting from day 8 or day 9, you will be able to see breeding cardiomyocytes that can be well characterized. So, and these not only starting from 8 days, and as you see, these cells at that point of time at day 8 is a very immature cardiomyocyte that is coming up, even though the whole layer is beating. But then you can allow these cells to mature in the same maintenance media that is provided along with this kit. And you can maintain them for greater than 28 days. And there are researchers who are, at least with our beta testers, who are able to manage till day 50, day 58. So maintenance medium is also available separately in case if you want to really pursue long term on these ones. So if you look at with this media performance, what is happening in those first 2 days after you switch to supplement A? You will see in the first one, the MIXL1 expression is going up. MESP1, which is clearly a mesoderm marker, is going up by day two. The MESP2, again, is going up really well within the first 2 days, and that is done on day three. And some of the very early on markers, you will see like black urine coming up on the differentiation path from pluripotent cells. So between day four and day six, you will also see very early cardiogenesis specification taking place. So the cells, or the MESP1 positive cells, are now being committed for the IL-1, GATA4, MEF2C, which is a really critical transcription factor that's really involved in pushing the cardiogenesis, and making these early cardio-specific cells to commit them for really fully mature or late-stage cardiogenic development. And from day 7 to day 15, I would say rather day 10 to day 15, you will see really cardiac, mature cardiac markers coming up, like the NKX2-5, cardiac troponin, TNN2, and myosin heavy chain 6. So these things show up very well in a time-dependent manner. And if you remember one of my earlier slides, where Mr. Vemuri has showed a developmental state of these cells moving on with specific markers, these are the markers that are shown in that panel, in the scheme as well. They follow the pattern. So the same, not only on the gene expression level by PCR, you can also see on immunocytochemistry at the level of protein expression. The figure that you see on the left side is that at day 10, the cells are stained. The green color is coming from cardiac troponin, and the pink one is NKX21, is the DAPI counter stain. And on the right side, you can also see the GATA4 showing up, MEF2C showing up, myosin 2, 4, and 6 stain, and the cardiac troponin that is shown in the red color. So not only at the gene expression level, it is being translated to the protein level, making these cells really functional. Right? So looking at the efficiencies, right? So what is shown here is that cardiac troponin we have used as a marker to analyze the differentiated cell progeny, and we'll see on the panel that is shown here, after all the background calculation and all that, it's coming to greater than 90% or 96%. And this is also possible. The media is defined, but at the same time, it also works on two different substrates that is shown on the bottom. And with differing cell densities, you can get differing efficiencies also. So with two different substrates, one of the reasons why we did with two different substrates, one is Geltrex, similar to Mathiazole, is that researchers could use Geltrex and get to this kind of cardiac differentiation. But if you are moving into a cell therapy and a regulatory compliant environment, you can also derive the same thing on vitronectin. We offer a product, a truncated vitronectin, and that is cell therapy systems compatible system, and this can be grown on those ones. And what is shown on the three different bars is the differing cell densities. With the differing cell densities, you can get differing efficiencies of this cardiac troponin positive cells ultimately. So we also compared with the different protocols like homebrewed, like researchers make their own media and then make it. So if you compare it with either B27 or STEMPRO34 kind of medias, that is the efficiencies that you see with cardiac troponin versus this one with different IPS lines. Similarly, with the differing lines also we have tested. With H9, human ESC, the variability is less. Or with human ESCs, looks like the variation is much smaller. So you can get as high efficiencies as 90% or above. What exactly it means, in other words, if you translate it, is if you plate for every one pluripotent cell, you are able to make roughly at least about 90 cardiomyocytes. That's what it translates to in simple terms. With IPS lines, we still see a slightly declining efficiencies. We don't know whether it is because of the epigenome signature that is still present on the cells, on the episomal lines we have used, and the episomal or cytochrome to sendite derived lines, But we are still screening. This is still a very early process. We are still screening many lines to see whether the different how it is working with different IPS lines. But definitely it gives you the cardiomyocytes that we generate that can be enriched. And one point again I want to say with this kind of thing is that not only the once you maintain these cells in the maturation media, the longer you maintain, the purer they become. These cells become more purer on those kind of things. What I would like to say at this point of conclusion slide is that there are two novel differentiation kits that Thermo Fisher has launched, and these are GMP manufactured. They are highly reproducible and highly regulatory compliant on these ones. And you know, on the neural induction media, it enables any kind of pluripotent stem cell line to get NSC in 7 days. These are at very high efficiency and high purity, and these are scalable, which meaning that these are expandable. Most neural types that you get see in this central nervous system and non-neural cell types like astrocytes and oligodendrocytes can be derived apart from the regional identity, regional specific neural subtypes like GABA neurons or dopaminergic neurons or motor neurons. And this is validated with multiple human ESC and IPS lines, and disease lines also you will see some data from Kurt Vogel. And it enables NSC derivation and differentiation of subneural types in iPSC disease models also very efficiently. Most neural types that you get see in this central nervous system and non-neural cell types like astrocytes and oligodendrocytes can be derived apart from the regional identity, regional specific neural subtypes like GABA neurons or dopaminergic neurons or motor neurons. And this is validated with multiple human ESC and IPS lines, and disease lines also you will see some data from Kurt Vogel. And it enables NSC derivation and differentiation of subneural types in iPSC disease models also very efficiently. On the cardiac side, so we can get this media, cardiac differentiation medium, enables pluripotent cells to generate contracting cardiomyocytes by day 8-9. And complete system, no supplementation needed. It is a 1x kind of media. Electrically coupled, observed as early as 8 days, and human ES lines and IPS episomal lines have shown it. And some of our beta testers also have shared their efficiencies with disease human IPS lines also to derive human disease IPS lines for alveolar and ventricular disease models on these lines. So with that, I think I will stop and take any questions. These are all the people I would like to thank on our end who have done a lot of this work in developing these products. Thank you, and look forward for questions.
There are microphones in the aisle, so if you want to ask a question, please come forward.
I actually had a question for Mohan. So Mohan, obviously a lot of these populations are heterogeneous.
Yeah.
When it comes to transplantation in the future, do you think that it's going to be important to have pure cell populations? Or do you think that this heterogeneity might be an advantage?
Yeah.
And then secondly, do you think that having the final terminally differentiated cell transplanted is important versus perhaps a precursor step?
Yeah, it depends on the system that we are looking for. I'll take the question and give you two answers. For example, neural, right? So it is practically impossible to take, for example, a dopaminergic neuron, which is fully mature with this entire process, to transplant back into animal models or human. So therefore, cells of that sort have to be taken at a restricted lineage precursor level. That means it is in the way, it is primed to differentiate into that ultimate phenotype. And at that stage of precursor, these have to be injected. Let's take on the example cardiac slightly differently. At this population, in these cells that I have just shown you, we still don't know the exact percentages of our cells within this, which we are still working on it. Very early on, we know we have quite a number of atrial cardiomyocytes, and then a little bit of nodal, and very less ventricular population. Whereas the mature ones, day 15, day 30 kind of cell cultures, we have high ventricular portion, very high, very low atrial, very low nodal. So for drug purposes, for drug discovery purposes, you need only ventricular cells for ventricular diseases. You need only atrial cells for atrial kind of diseases. So you will pick and choose and enrich this population. There are ways to enrich these populations very simply. By depriving their energy and all that, you can get to the specified cell type. Maturation and isolation is much easier at this level of high efficiencies. So therefore, for transplantation purposes, if you're transplanting for the whole heart, one need to identify what cell type has damage in there. What is the cell type that is there? So then you may have to mix the stoichiometric ratio of those cell types and then transplant them back. So these are scene by scene, case by case, you have to alter those strategies.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the audience?
I'm still around, so if you guys don't have questions, I'll be around here throughout the stem cell meeting. I will be happy to talk to anybody, either at the booth or you can catch me on the go. So anytime, I'll be happy to discuss on any of these lineages and questions you might have.
Yeah, I have two questions.
Sure.
A very nice presentation, and I'm looking forward to testing your cardiomyocyte differentiation medium. And I thought you compared the method to making iPSCs.
Yeah.
But did you test the original cell cells? Make any difference? Like, all those cells are from fibroblasts?
I couldn't quite get your question. Can you repeat your question?
Yes. I found you said there's a difference, like the episomal vectors
yeah.
and the sun dye. But are those cells all from fibroblasts?
Yes. So
do you test the other cell types? Like
yeah.
The,
yeah. So we have generated quite a number of cell types, starting from fibroblasts and also from CD34 cells and also from peripheral blood mononuclear cells, PBMCs. So we are still in the process of testing a lot of these things, any variations coming on. And that's why we feel the difference that we are seeing in particular with the cardiac differentiation, we believe the iPSCs generated from different sources and different methods might still have epigenome alterations, changes in those ones. We still are not conclusive about it. We still need to test and ascertain those things.
Okay, thank you. And my second question is, seems you can use the vitronectin as a matrix
yes.
for cardiomyocyte differentiation.
Yes.
And after you're making this, can you quite preserve the cells and sell the cells? Do you still using my vitronectin as a matrix?
Excellent question. Mm-hmm. The spontaneous electrical activity that is shown in one of my panels of the video that I showed is actually the cells. We generate the cardiomyocytes at day 15. We isolate them, cryopreserve them for a few days, thaw them out, and then do these ones on this. So these are the cells that are cultured in vitronectin or gelflex. There is no big difference on their functionality, and they survive. I wouldn't recommend cryopreservation at day 10, but definitely after 15. So day 10 is still whole differentiation process is a very stressful event for the cells. And stressing them out by cryopreservation and thawing at day 10 is like, you know, they are too early for sustaining the pressure from cryopreservation.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for your talk. I'm just wondering if your neural induction medium contains animal derived component in it.
Any animal component?
Yes. Geno-free or not?
It is not geno-free yet. It's still not geno-free yet. There is some component of BSA in it that we have to clarify. But if you're interested in cell therapy purposes, we can make one for you with non-BSA.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks for the wonderful talk. I have two simple questions. The first is your neuron induction medium, they pass a stage called neuron rosette?
Yeah.
So they still form neuron rosette?
Yes. So the question, I repeat the question for audience. The question is, the NSCs that we have generated, originally embryoid body, no embryoid body, we bypassed it. No rosette formation, we bypassed it. But the NSCs that we got at day 7, can they still form rosette structures? Yes, if you plate them at low density, they can form those rosette structures.
The other question is, since you have a very robust expansion ability mm-hmm. for those neuron differentiation protocol,
yeah.
do they downregulate the polypotency genes in your culture system, or why they can expand such robustly as a neural stem cell?
This is what we believe. The NSC phenotype that we are differentiating using this method, they maintain the primitive stem state. So they have the ability, relatively better ability than the ROSA-derived ones to go after a few passages. So we have tested up to passage 12, and some of our customers have gone up to passage 15. Beyond that, we have not tested. What I also mean is we have not really tested the limitations of expansion ability beyond passage 15. But I'm sure at some point of time they'll go down.
How about the upper stacks to the pluripotency genes?
So pluripotency genes are downregulated at P0, quite extensively. So even if you have a limited, like less than 1% of four positive cells, they are gone by passage 2. Or passage 1, may call it as passage 1.
Thank you, Mohan.